the Father's heart displayed for us. Oh God, we thank you for the cross lifted up on Calvary's hill. We cursed your name. Worship video stopped early, so you know what that means. It's time to worship. Are we ready this morning, church? Online family, how are we doing out there?
Yeah, I hear you.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy,
many got lots of just pollen in your chest right now? Anybody? Everybody? Good. No promises this morning on what might happen. If you hear me crack, just laugh and go on about it. Make a joyful noise to the Lord.
The giants fall.
In the darkness, we were waiting without hope and without light. Till from heaven you came running, and there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Oh, and praise the Father, and praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. And God of glory, majesty, oh, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. Before even in your suffering, you talked to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus for our sake. Till the storm was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, and then the Spirit filled the flame. Now the sky.
Better. Thank you for the foundation offering. We've got the final, the numbers that came in from our special offering we had in the, to allocate toward the foundation of the church. The $11,895 was given on that Sunday. That's tremendous for this church this size. Since the first of the year, it's $13,620 have been given since the first of the year towards the building. So it's tremendous. You know, all we need is a few loaves and fishes, and God will do the rest. And so I don't know how many loaves we have right now, but we're headed that way, and we want to thank you for your generosity. Not too much other things in the announcements. The Craft Festival is coming up. We're looking forward to it. We need your help. Please contact Sandy or Jamie Holt if you can help out, if you can volunteer. And we'd like for everybody to be there and represent the church. I think that's about it. So with that, I'll turn it over to Pastor Jerry.
Good morning. I'm sorry about that. I really wanted to do a solo this morning for you. Came in a little hot. Just a little bit. Okay. Good to see all of you this morning. Nate is right. The allergy stuff is just going crazy. I'm having struggles because I had to mow the grass, and it's really Sandy's fault because she wouldn't mow it. So that's where I'm at this morning. But man, it's great to see all of you. Hey, we're gonna look at another part of our story here, getting towards the end of the book of Ephesians, and then we're gonna take a little break and watch a video, and then we'll come back and look at three imperatives, three action items that God wants us to take from our passage this morning in our story. Wants us to add some things to our life and to our story. But we know that spiritual forces have been at work. That's the reason we're here this morning, because God touched our life. God touched our heart. The Holy Spirit drew us to the Lord, and we repented. We accepted Christ as our Savior. We're here this morning because we want to continue learning about that and continuing to have Him build up into our lives. And so we're here this morning because of the spiritual forces from God's perspective that are at work in our life. But we also have to understand that there is another aspect of spiritual forces at work in the world today, and they are alive and well, and that is the evil side of spiritual forces. Satan is at work, and our story takes place, is what Paul is saying here at the end of this, that our story takes place on a battlefield. We don't see it. We don't always recognize it. We don't ever, admit it or even think about it. But every day we're in the middle of a battlefield each and every day. So at the end of this passage, Paul gives some very serious instruction to the church at Ephesus. And we pick it up in chapter 6 and verse number 10. And we're just going to be able to get through three verses this morning. So let's read those three. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. So Paul here is giving us a message that is absolutely timeless. Even though this was given in the first century, it is something that's been around since man first stepped foot on the earth in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. The spiritual needs of people have never changed. And this battle that takes place has always taken place and will always take place. The evil one exists and the evil one is active. In the Garden of Eden, where he entered in the Garden of Eden, God created Adam and Eve and declared that everything was good. Every time God is working, so is Satan working. Every time God is present, Satan is present. Every time God is doing something, Satan is also doing something. And in the Garden of Eden, though he had a victory there with Adam and Eve and made them fall and made them sin and be disobedient to God, and so it became a part of this earth, and the earth became a fallen place, and each of us were born as as fallen creatures because of the sin that Adam and Eve allowed into their life through the temptation of Satan. That was just Satan's beginning. The Garden of Eden was just a staging area for Satan. Just as much as Satan is at work in Adam and Eve's life, he's at work in your life, and he's at work in my life. He thinks about your wife the same way he thought about Eve. He thinks about Adam the same way he thinks about you. He thinks about your children just like he thought about their children. And so the Garden of Eden is just his staging area. We know that Satan has influence and control. And it's a different take on Paul's narrative here of God narrating our story, because up until this point, it's always been pretty much ideal circumstances that Paul has talked about. He talks about the victory that we've had in Christ through first and second chapter, what we once were, what we've been delivered from, and now what we all have in our identity in Jesus Christ, and how we can put on Christ and we can be a totally different creature and a new creation. And then he talked about the ideal circumstances of parenting and of marriage and of slaves and of masters. And in those three ideals, he's talking to the church at Ephesus, and he's assuming that all of those people are believers. So if you're a mom or a dad, he's saying you're both Christians. This is how you're to respond in this situation. That's ideal circumstances. If you're married, husband and wife, this is how you're to live as husband and wife. He gives us that exhortation, and it's easy because they both respond to it because they're both believers. Now, he deals in other areas, in other parts of Scripture, when there's a person that is a believer married to an unbeliever, and how that is supposed to be carried out as far as God's perspective. But then he gets into the thing with masters and slaves. He's assuming that both of them are believers. All ideal circumstances. And now Paul turns the page, and he it's like he says, finally, this is a fitting conclusion. And he says, if you haven't listened to anything else, you need to hear this. You need to understand this. You may not recognize until now, but there is a spiritual battle in the world today. And you're a part of it. And you're in the thick of it. Whether you realize it or not, it is that the enemy is crouching at the door. The enemy is crouching at the door. I had a friend that I met briefly in life out in California, and he had just rolled out of the Army as a sniper. I found out that he was a sniper. I mean, I'm looking at all these pictures in his apartment, and I'm amazed. And he goes, oh, most of those are just staging pictures. We just picked up any weapon that we could and got it up next to us and took pictures of it or whatever. But he was a sniper, and he says, so his first job was that very first Desert Storm where they dropped them over into enemy lines, and they were spotters. So they spotted the enemy coming, and they were to be lookouts, advanced lookouts for people to come in. And he said, I'll never forget the commanding officer telling us, when you go out there and you're dropped off, I want you to understand the reality of this situation. When you see some movement in the desert, it is going to be the sixth largest army on the face of the earth that will be coming across that desert. And you're going to be our eyes and ears. He said that was so sobering. But then the commanding officer said, but you don't need to worry about the sixth most powerful army in the world, because you're fighting for the number one most powerful army in the world. And that's what Paul is saying here. Hey, there's some danger. There's some things you got to be aware of. And it is very, very serious. I mean, you could be taken out, and the enemy wants to take you out. But he's saying that you have the ability to be protected. You have the ability to have victory day in and day out on the battlefield. So whether you realize it or not, this world is under the control and the influence of the evil one. Satan wants to strip you of your position and your purpose in Christ Jesus. And he doesn't have to get us to do bad to keep us from fulfilling our position and our purpose in Christ. He doesn't have to get us to sin to keep us from fulfilling our position and our purpose in Christ. So the setting of our story, the atmosphere that we're in today, that there are evil forces at work. It's an evil place. There are evil systems, and all of these oppose God. pretty much you need to understand that everything in this world will oppose God. It's philosophies, it's science, it's thoughts, what is popular, what is trending. Most of that, 90% of that, is going to be in direct opposition to God and His Word and what is truth. This world is full of darkness, full of darkness. Now, who is Satan? Where did Satan come from? What is his beginning? Why is he even here? Well, Satan is a created being, and he was created by God as an angel. And then one day, Satan decided he didn't want to be just created by God and an angel of God. He wanted to be God. He wanted to become God. He has several names. Lucifer was his name that was given to him. He's the son of dawn or the star of the morning. He's called those names also, which kind of imitate the day star, one of the names for Christ, the names for God. But he has some of those same names, and he was a brilliant angel. He was a very powerful angel. He was maybe one of the greatest, most powerful angels that God created. Now, we know that God created a lot of different angels, and there's a lot of different levels of angels. The archangel, a lot of scholars believe that Lucifer was one of the archangels. We know from Scripture, from the Bible, that three archangels are named. It doesn't mean that's all there is, but we know that there are three that are named, and it is Lucifer, it is Michael, and it is Gabriel. There are some extra biblical writings that say there's seven angels. Some in the Catholic Bible talk about seven different archangels. But of all the angels that are created, I mean, the Bible describes them as innumerable. You can't number them. And there's so many of them. God created so many of these angels. But Satan was an angel until he decided that he wanted to be God. And we get a little bit of his story in one place from Isaiah chapter 14. And this is Satan's five I wills. You can remember it that way, that he said, I'm going to do five things. There's five declarations of my rebellion against God. And it says this in Isaiah 14, 12 through 14. How are you fallen from heaven, O day star, son of dawn, talking about Satan? How you are cut down to the ground, you who laid the nations low. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven, I above the stars of God. I will set my throne on high. I will sit on the mount of the assembly in the far reaches of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. So because of this, God kicked Satan out of heaven. He threw him out of heaven. He cast him down. And we know that from the scripture narrative that Satan, Lucifer, took a third of the angels with him. One third of the angels, and these became what we would say are his demons today. They were angels, now they're demons. Now they're working for the evil of Satan and doing his bidding, and he rules over this world. And believe it or not, Paul has alluded to this already in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 2, where he says that Satan is the prince of the power of this air. So Satan has some control and has some ability to influence and to defeat people in this world today. And I don't know if you've looked around. When you see some of the heinous crimes that are being committed, you're like, this is someone that is satanic. This is someone that is possessed by an evil spirit that is able to do these things. Now, I've not ever seen that. I was talking with a guy this week, and he was from California. He moved out here. His name's John, and John was telling me that most of his family is in law enforcement, and he has an uncle that retired from the corrections in California, and that his job was transfer prisoners, and he even transferred Mason. What's that guy's name? Charles Manson. He transferred Charles Manson, and he says, you got to sit there in the back of this pickup, back of this truck, in this cargo facility, and you watch him the whole time. And he said, it was just pure evil. You could just see it in his eyes and in his face, pure evil. So we know that Satan has control and he works, but he also not just works in people, but he works most of his work over kingdoms through kings and rulers and in governments. Because of him, there are world governments that are controlled by Satan, which Daniel chapter 10 talks about, and Ephesians chapter 6 here in verse number 12 about the prince of the power of the air. Evil is good, is what Satan says, and good is evil. Does that sound familiar? Philosophies today, ideology, what people are presenting as truth, evil is good, and good is evil. And it has always been that way. Always been that way. Remember in the city of Ephesus, it was turned upside down by the gospel of Jesus Christ. They changed completely. People's lives were totally transformed. And Demetrius, the silversmith, got so angry because it was costing him money because of his false gods, his little silver trinkets that he was selling for people to worship. People weren't buying them anymore. And so they attacked Paul and they attacked believers, and Paul nearly lost his life over this. But Satan says evil is good and good is evil. Satan is an usurper and an imitator of God. Listen, you, I pray, have never been in this situation, but there will be things that you have said in your life that God gave you and God had no part of it. Satan gave you something and you're claiming it was God's, and it may not ever have been God's. It very well could have been Satan. Just a year ago, a man now, a teenager that grew up in our church, somebody that was very near and dear to, he's married and got three kids, but he'd been having an ongoing affair, and his comment was, this person that God gave me in my affair is who God gave me. I mean, this God brought this person in my life. I mean, they get me. They know and they understand. I said, you know who gets you is your kids. Who gets you is the wife that God gave you. Don't say God gave you this. God had nothing to do with this. You see, Satan always wants to imitate and give you a version of what God wants to give you, but it never turns out the way God will make it turn out. It only turns out the way Satan will turn it out, the way Satan wants it to do it. So this is Satan. He's an usurper and an imitator of God. He is a deceiver, and he tries to copy everything that God is and everything that God does. The New Testament presents the evil as a plurality of demons. And you see it over and over throughout the life of Christ and him dealing with these evil spirits. But the New Testament then presents Satan as the head there. And even in 1 Peter, we know that Satan is likened, the analogy is given that he is a lion. He is a lion that walks about seeking whom he may devour. Be careful that Satan walks around like a lion. He's roaring and he wants to devour. So think about this in your life and in my life. Though Satan is not omnipresent, Satan has been present in his person in our life at some point in time. We didn't know it. We didn't recognize it, but he has walked by us. He maybe even has told God something about us. He's maybe even said our name. He knows us. He knows our name. He knows what we're capable of. He knows what we're prone to commit, what is wrong with our sin nature. He knows us more than we know ourselves. This is the power of Satan, and it is so real. But understand this, though that sixth largest army is going to come across the desert, you fight for the first most powerful army. Satan is not equal with God. It's not like it's good versus evil. It's not like it's God versus Satan. There is no comparison. It's no comparison. That would be like comparing Kansas University football with Alabama. With Alabama. Now, a few years ago, Kansas had won like, or had won, oh my goodness, had lost like 24 football games straight. I forget what it was. And we beat a ranked team in regular season play for the first time in like 3 years. We beat Texas. And college kids come up with the most brilliant things. There in the stands was somebody with a sign that said, "We want Bama." Because we beat Texas. Now, you've got to be a football fan to be able to appreciate that. But there's just no equal. Satan is not God's equal. Satan is still under the control of God. God even uses what he does for his own purposes and good. So he's under God's control, and he is still subject to God. I want to show you this video. 4 minutes, 16 seconds. Let's pay attention here just a moment.
I just wanted to stop by and give you a little update on what's going on. Now, some of you don't have a clue as to who I am, but there's others of you that know exactly who I am. And let's be clear on one thing. I know who you are. I spend as much time as I can with most of you. And here's the part that should make you a little uncomfortable. I spent a lot of time with your children. And thanks to some of you, they don't even know what to look out for. Sure, there's times I kind of wish I did the whole horns, pitchfork, and red cape thing, but, you know, that would make it too easy for you guys. You see, the great thing for me is that I don't look like anything. I can look like just about everything. I don't have to be here. Some of the best work I do with you people is up here. Now, some of you are thinking, I'm successful, I live a good life, my family's happy, you don't have me. Well, guess what? I can take you down in more ways than you understand. I have one goal, and that's to keep you away from God. And if I can make you miserable in the process, well, bonus for me. And for those of you that don't understand the problem that I have with our Creator, read the book. It's all in there. Now, I want you to think of all the places you've seen me in the past week. TV, newspaper, radio, movies, the internet. The internet, wow. Wow, I love that place. Do you know that I have over 420 million pages of porn on that thing? And it does almost $5 billion in revenue a year and growing. Thanks in part to many of you. Let me let you in on a little secret. And I don't mind either. You know why I don't mind? Because most of you will forget everything that was said in this service by the time you walk out those back doors. Are you ready for this? All you have to do is choose to avoid me. You want to know the best thing God ever did for me was to give you the ability to choose? You see, you can't not choose. Here's the greatest thing about it. By not choosing him, you automatically choose me. Now, some of you have figured out how to keep me away, and quite frankly, there's no mystery to it. James 4:7, resist the devil and he will flee. But most of you choose to allow me free reign in your life. You know, there's that word again, choose. I have drugs, porn, infidelity, greed, lust, pride, slander, and the list goes on and on and on. But the one thing I do not have is the ability to offer you freedom. You know, to see Jesus suffer on that cross was one of the greatest moments of my life. Then when he was with me, the burning and the torture that he felt was at my hands. And I loved it. I loved every second of his torture. But you know what I couldn't stop thinking of? I couldn't stop thinking about why he was there. During that time, I could only think of one thing. That when his torment was over, it meant that all of humanity, every one of you, would have the chance for an eternal life of peace. And all you would have to do is simply choose. You know, I know how this is going to end. I know what's in store for me. I will be condemned to an eternal hell, but until that day, I will do everything in my power to unleash that hell on this earth. And as God, as my witness, if you even allow me the smallest corner of your life, I will not stop until I destroy you. And until you cry for mercy in Christ's sake, I will not let you go. When the service is over, I will be waiting. I'll be waiting for some of you at work, at school, or at home. You know, I'll even see some of you in the car outside. Just remember, it's either me or him. Who do you choose?
Paul goes on to say, let's dress for success. Three things that you have to put on, three things that you have to be, three imperatives, three things to do. Real quickly, the essentials in this passage: be strong, put on the full armor of God, and stand. Overall, the theme is stand. Overall, the theme is get up. But he says, be strong, put on the full armor of God, and stand. We don't put these pieces on through prayer. We put these pieces on through practice. Not saying prayer isn't important. It plays a big role, and we'll see as we go on with this instruction from Paul. But we put these pieces on not through prayer, but through practice. These characteristics and virtues, they unite us with Christ. And as we're united with our commander, the one that is over us, the one that is greater than Satan, then we have are better able to withstand against him. So he says to put on Christ. And he said this over and over and over throughout the book of Ephesians. And it's recognizing who Jesus is, that we are his, and that we live consistently with that identity that we are Christ and we're not Satan's, that we're not of this world, we're of another world. So the three must-haves. The first one is be strong. Be strong. He says you don't need to fear. You don't need to fear. When you think about the evil that is in the world today, listen, it's not a ghost show on TV. That is not the evil in this world. The evil in this world is not the things that look bad, but it's the things that look good that are there. And we don't need to fear those. We know a lot about fear. We know that a lot of about fear that we've been cowering in our homes, that we're afraid to go out, that we're going to get this disease, this virus that is out there. But he says you need to be strong. Be strong. No need to fear. He says in 1 John 4:4, little children, you are from God and have overcome them, for he who is in you is greater than he that is in the world. When we've put on Christ, because we are Christ, because that is our identity, we're greater than the forces of evil. The power in us is greater than the evil around us. If we're not strong, then we withdraw. We stop to engage. We hide and we void our influence. We no longer are strong for the Lord. We live in fear. We live in the shadows. And that isn't what we're to do and be as believers at all. So we're to be strong. And the next thing he says in these verses is put on the full armor of God. Put on the full armor of God. This reveres back to chapter 4 and verse number 24, where he says, put on the new self, created to be like God in true holiness and righteousness. These are things that we practice, that we put on the full armor of God, that are the practice of true holiness and righteousness. Putting on the new self is putting on the armor of God. That is the armor of God. And listen, the armor of God can be understood three ways. First of all, it is the armor that God provides. So we know God is saying, this is the armor that you're to put on. But then the second thing is the armor that God himself wears. God himself wears this. This is God. This is who he is. But it's even the armor that is God himself. So those three ways, the armor that God provides, the armor that God himself wears, and the armor that is God himself. You know, the characteristics of God can be summed up with three of them. Truth, righteousness, and salvation. Truth, righteousness, and salvation. We're going to get to the armor of God in the coming days, but look at the armor. If you look ahead, there is the belt of what? Truth. God's characteristics are truth. What is the breastplate of what? Righteousness. Truth, righteousness. And what is the helmet of? Salvation. The characteristics of God, truth, righteousness, and salvation. Put on the belt, that is truth. Put on the breastplate, that is righteousness. Put on the helmet of salvation, the characteristics of God. Remember who we are told to imitate back in chapter 5 and verse number 1? We imitate God. That is who we remember that we imitate, that we follow, that we are his and we follow him. Only by taking on the characteristics of God can we be strong. This call to action is not to individuals, but it is to an entire church. He's saying, church at Ephesus, you absolutely have to put this on so you'll be effective and you'll be able to stand against Satan and all of his schemes and all of his things that he does in your life and wants to accomplish in the world today. So collectively, we put them on, Argo Christian Fellowship, and stand as one person with all of us with our armor on. So then the third thing he says is stand, stand. You don't fight from a seated position. You don't fight from lounging back. He says stand, and stand against the schemes of the devil. A scheme is something that is not easily seen. They are not blatant. The true intention for that scheme is camouflaged. Evil rarely looks evil. Evil is a baited and camouflaged trap. Some time ago, I had a parent ask me, what age did you give your kids a cell phone? what age do you think kids should have a cell phone? And my answer was, wait as long as you possibly can. Wait as long as you possibly can. Abby was, I think, 10 or 12, her birthday. She thought she was getting a cell phone. Instead, we got her a little thing that does music. I don't forget what it's called. But she was so excited that it was going to be something like an iPhone that she could communicate. But it wasn't. It was just played music. That's all it was. You know, I would wait as long as you possibly can. Because you're introducing them to things they're not prepared yet how to handle. They're still forming their opinions and their thoughts, and that's all they're going to get on that phone is people's opinions and thoughts that have no clue what to do in this world, how to act, how to live. Most of that is, as Satan said himself, it is under the control of Satan. So be very, very careful, because they will adopt a worldview and not a biblical view. And that is not what we're to be. Remember, Paul said in the Ephesians, these things are not to even be named among you, going through this list of sins. You're not supposed to be like this. You're not supposed to live like this. I don't even want them to be talked about among you as believers. Evil seldom looks like evil. 2 Corinthians 11, 13 and 14 says this, for such men are false apostles, deceitful workers, masquerading as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. That is Satan. Whatever he brings into our life, it's going to look right. It's going to look good. It's going to be logical from a human perspective. So to stand is to be ready to face the challenge. Don't sit or lounge. Get up. Be ready. Stand where you can see what's going on. Rise above the circumstances through the identity that you have in Jesus Christ. Well, when we close this thing up this morning, just from these three simple verses, these three verses of an introduction to an incredible battle that we're in, our story is a spiritual story. It is lived out in both the physical and the spiritual realm. And we know that the spiritual and the physical, they go together there. They combine together, that they're inseparable, that one is one and the other is the other. Through salvation in Jesus Christ, that we have been transformed from this world to the kingdom of God, from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. Children of disobedience, we've been made children of obedience. From morality for mortality to immortality, from life to everlasting life. That is our identity in Christ. Let God continue to narrate our story, because there is someone there that wants to change that narrative. He wants to speak some what will sound like truth into our life, and he'll try to take us out. Satan wants to narrate our story. Satan's schemes are intended to disrupt our spiritual life as God intends it. Well, not only does Satan want to narrate our story, I don't know if you know this, but Satan is already narrating our story, or he's trying to. He's active. Satan, as I said earlier, is not omnipresent, but I'll tell you where he is most of the time. He's before the throne of God. There's a name for Satan you may not be aware of, but it's found in Revelation chapter 12. Satan is the accuser of the believers. So he may not be in a world government. He doesn't have to be. He's got that ball rolling. He started that ball rolling, and it's heading exactly where it needs to go. He may not need to be in a person's life. He's got that thing going. It's right where it's supposed to be. Satan is at the throne room of God. And this is Satan's worst name, the accuser of the brethren. That he would ever utter your name makes me furious. That he would ever utter my name or the name of my wife or of my kids before God in a derogatory manner makes me furious. Makes me furious. Revelation chapter 12 and verse number 1 says this, and I heard a great voice in heaven saying, now is come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accuses them before our God day and night. You see, the story about Job in the Old Testament is not an isolated story. That's a commonplace story. It's just we got a glimpse of it. We got to understand it. But Job had no way of knowing that Satan was before God saying, oh, I see this righteous man. The only reason he serves you is because you protect him. If you just would take away his protection, he would curse you. He would turn against you. This is Satan's daytime, nighttime job before the throne of God, talking about us, talking about our fellow believers. He accuses us of what we do. If he can know what sin we're involved in, he can accuse them before God. Oh, really, this is your child. This is the way they act. This is how they live. I thought you said in your word, this is the way they're supposed to be. But this one is living this way. This one is thinking this way. And there's accuser of what we do. But I think more importantly, it's the accuser of what we don't do. If this is so important and the death of Jesus Christ was so important, then why don't they live according to that forgiveness and the change that's been taking place in their life? Why don't they talk about, why don't they share truth and righteousness and holiness with others? You see, what we omit is sometimes we just have a form of godliness, but we have no power, and we become ineffective for the gospel. Let's read this entire passage as we close this morning, because it's so important and it ties it together for us. Ephesians chapter 6. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this incredible warning and challenge that we have. The reality of the life that we're living for you is lived out in a world that is full of darkness and is against us. Father, I pray that we'd be a church that is dressed for success, that we would have on us the armor that protects us, the armor that we can move forward, that we can go forward, that we can proclaim the name of Jesus Christ. Make us this kind of people. Father, help us to know that there is an evil out there and to take it seriously. Protect our children, protect our young people, protect our moms and dads and our grandpas and grandpas, protect all of us. Father, I pray that we would stand firm, we'd be strong in the Lord, and I pray it in the name of Jesus Christ and for his sake, amen. Would you stand, please? Let's close out this morning with a time of worship.
Wherever you lead me, whatever it costs me, oh, all I want is you, Jesus, all I want is you.